it's 12 o'clock, and I think it's time I get out of the hotel and go do something. So I did some research, found out there's a pretty good air and space museum, so I'm going to go take a look at it. So, let's go. Well, this is one of my favorite places to go, the Nautilus Diner. Calling it a diner is really bad. I mean, it's like a four-star restaurant. The food here is absolutely fabulous. Now, that's matzo ball soup. Got my tea and my matzo ball soup. I'm all set. You could really mess up a diet here.
Yeah.
Big time. We made it here. It's a big place. I just got here, and as you can see from looking around, it's quite expansive. So I got about 2.5 hours, so let's go explore. Well, if you want aircraft, they've got aircraft. Must have got a lot of kids out here today. Can you imagine what it was like to fly in something like this? We've come a long way, huh? Now, this building doesn't look that big from the outside, but when you get in here, you realize just how big it is. There's the Enola Gay. Come across to the other side of the walk here, and you see they've got a Boeing 707, and behind that, I don't know whether you can see it or not, they've got a Concorde. This place is huge. And then in between all of the exhibits, they've got a lot of these other little aircraft of interest. They've got hundreds of aircraft. I have no idea how many they've got here. Suffice it to say, they've got a lot.
This is the Enola Gay. Enola Gay is a Boeing B-29 Super Fortress bomber. It was named the Enola Gay after the mother of the pilot, Paul Tibbets. On 6th of August, 1945, during the final stages of the World War II, it became the first aircraft to drop an atomic bomb as a weapon of war. This is the one that dropped the bomb on Hiroshima.
Now, we've come a little way since aircraft like this, the Boeing 707 here. But can you imagine what it was like to fly a long distance in something like this? Boy, you talk about it being a bumpy flight, huh? If you're interested in photography, you'll find this part of the museum interesting. These are all different types of cameras which were mounted in different aircraft throughout history. And they range from very small handheld all the way up to very large cameras that were, well, these are also handheld, but they've also got some that were mounted. Some of them were actually mounted like the machine gun would be mounted as part of the aircraft. And they even had a little bomb sight on them and everything. But it's actually not a gun, it's a camera. It's a movie camera for taking detailed images. And there's quite a collection of them here. And then after they've got their pictures, they had different processing things that they would do for measurement and stereo vision and so forth.
They've got quite a collection of helicopters here too. All different sizes and ages. And more modern. So they've got some of the older ones. And they've even got some little micro helicopters up here too. Pretty cool. When you see the landing gear on an aircraft, you don't really think about how big it is. And then when you get right in front of it, you kind of realize just how big it really is. This is just the landing gear, and it's almost 2 stories tall. That'll give you an idea just how big it is.
interesting aircraft. It's actually a kite. It was enabled German submarines in World War II to locate targets in heavy seas. It could go as high as 722 feet, and that allowed the pilot to see about 33 miles out. But the commanders didn't like it because it gave away their position on radar, so they didn't use them very much. I still think it's pretty ingenious.
An easily recognizable aircraft.
It's the SR-71 Blackbird. See how big a space shuttle is? This is how big it is. Get right up on it here. It's a big aircraft. More correctly, a big spacecraft. To fit it all in. This is one of three of the 3,000 pound main engines for the space shuttle. To give you an idea, this thing is about 10 foot in diameter. It's pretty large. I'm sure the dentists will get a kick out of this one, that they made sure they had good oral hygiene in space. I don't imagine that toothpaste tasted too good, though. It's also a collection of the different gloves used. They actually molded them to the astronauts' hands so that they would fit perfectly. And some of the earlier ones, they put lighting in the fingertips so that they could view the instrument panels with it. And then in the background, you see the extra vehicular gloves, which were beefed up even more because of all the different things they were exposed to. And then above that, we've got the different helmets. This is an Apollo series helmet. And before that, this is a Mercury series helmet. And if we go around the corner, this is a G4C or Gemini helmet. This is the Vega solar system probe, or actually a mock-up of the one that's actually out there. And it's kind of hard to believe now just how much technology has changed. This was the control panel for it. And this was the computer that was used. You can see how much things have changed in just a few years. We're at the Air and Space Museum, and I just wanted to show you, just to give you an idea of the scale of some of these things. What you're seeing behind me is an Atlas Centaur rocket engine. And you can see, it's a big engine. But there's a lot of big stuff here to see. If you go and look behind me, you'll see the laboratory section that was used in the space shuttle. And then behind me now, you can actually see the tail section for the space shuttle. So, cool place to come visit. What you're seeing here is the Space Lab laboratory section that was flown in the space shuttle, where they conducted a lot of different experiments. They've got a lot of the parts of it that were used. What you see here is a section that connects between the space shuttle and the space station, allows the astronauts to go between the two. And over here you'll see some more engines and rockets and all kinds of things, and behind me is the tail end of the Enterprise, the space shuttle that was used to test the idea of flying a shuttle on the back of an aircraft to ferry it from point to point. This is pretty cool spy stuff. This is a Corona capsule. They had these satellites that would go up, and what they would do is they would take photographs over Russia, and then at some point in time, they would drop down to Earth and they would leave a parachute behind them, and then an aircraft would come along and whip them right out of midair, and then they'd go and develop their film. Another point of interest that you might find pretty cool is if we come over here, especially people that are into photography like Eve, this is a light table, and this was used to examine the film in high detail. And even though there's a lot of digital media out there, these light tables are still used. And they could look at two different rolls at once and do stereoscopic imagery. So they're still useful today. Here's one of the Atlas rocket sections, and below it, I thought you'd find this interesting. This is the, for its day, advanced computer system that ran it. My, how times have changed. A lot of the stuff back then is displayed this way. Looks like a piece out of a Hollywood movie, but it's real. And then here's their tape drive. The paper tapes were used to store the data. Here. One of the things I thought was really neat is this is the mothership that was used in the movie Close Encounters of the Third Kind. And after reading a little blurb, there's some little things that weren't shown in the movie. If you go down and look right inside of here, you'll see that there's a little cemetery. It was put in there. There's also a VW bus, and there's an R2-D2 and a mailbox, but I have to find them yet. But pretty cool. Some girls just pointed it out to me, hiding on the mothership. There's the R2-D2 there. And then if you look over here, inside of the belly of the mothership, there's a little cemetery, see it? That's pretty cool. Now I just have to find the VW bus and the mailbox that they hid on here. Here's the radar dish that was used in the F-4. I used to work on this. For a couple years, this was my job, keeping this thing fixed. Boy, it seems like a century ago. Got all kinds of different aircraft engines here, ranging from some of the bigger ones down to some of the littler ones. The mechanic in me wants to tear them apart and fix them and make them work. This is pretty cool. They've got it closed right now, but they've got a simulator set up here of the space shuttle so that people can sit down and try flying a mission on the space shuttle. Just coming back here for dinner. Check that out. That's a chicken a la Nautilus. That's chicken and green peppers and red peppers.